couple things, and again, just thinking mentally as you go into this and talk to different folks, because you've got a wide playground of folks that you're talking to. So, you know, I always look at it as on the debt side, you get low cost money that you can get a lot of flexibility with in terms right. of, like, if you take a term loan, you can have some flexibility with it. But if you get a revolver, which is probably closer to what you're going to do here, could be a mix of the two. But they're going to have some covenants on it because the banks, you know, the banks always got to think about them. I think of, if you've ever taken a finance course, there's the graph of the efficient frontier. And mm-hmm. in short, all it is a graph of risk and return. The more risk you take, the more return you expect, right? Yeah. And so banks, what they think it's useful is no one really thinks about it, but banks are over here at 5-6% return. Maybe some lenders are up to 10-11% return. But that's relatively low if you consider that your angel investors, you know, angels are stoked if they get 1-2x. So they're over here on risk. And then your VC investors are way over here at 10x, right? So you're going to have the goals and the risk that they're willing to take are going to be different. And the pricing and the flexibility that they have all has to do with the risk. So another mental thing, these PE and venture, they are looking forward. They care about what you did in the past, but they are looking for that promise and the dream. And the great thing a lot of entrepreneurs have, how can you not want to invest in this? I had a little gas. I can turn this thing on. Look at what we have. Just look past 6 months. This thing nearly happens. It's great. Whereas banks look at it and say, what did you do the last 2 years? And some, we're kind of in this funny space where we look backward. We love the going forward, but in specific to SVB and venture lending, we'll look forward as long as we have a VC private equity partner to do it with. And so you're also in a different stage too, because you have profitability currently.
Yes.
And I'm sure you know this, you're on the cusp. You're a services business that has a SaaS product. So services, again, just so you hear what people think about, so both VCs and banks will look at services and say, oh gosh, that's really hard because the intellectual property is in the heads of your people.
Exactly.
And if there's a falling out, they go out and open their own or they're gone. I got nothing left as enterprise value. So that's what makes it really hard in the lending. Now, so where does that leave us? Either A, if you've got some of these private equity people, you know, maybe you too take a bit of a secondary. Take some secondary for your co-person. You take a little bit just to kind of ease stuff and like, okay, now I'm going to crank on this thing.
Right.
And because I'm going to take over for, I'm assuming you buy out your other person and now you're ready to go. So that's probably the easiest path to that. Banks will have a hard time having capital go out and not to operationally, like what banks like to do is I see your funnel. I'm going to lend you $5 million. You're going to put that in the top of the funnel and you got, you know, 10 million coming out the bottom. Oh, that looks great. I can do that. I don't like to see, oh, I'm going to give you 5 and you're going to give 2 to her, 1 to him. What they're trying to do is entice you because they know that you're saying, wait a minute, this is my baby and you want how much for, maybe they're going to put 15 million in, right?
Right.
How does that happen? Then you got to think, okay, this is why I always think, don't think about today. Think about 18 to 24 months from now. What does that money, what does that debt do for you?
Right.
If it gets you, and maybe it's multiple steps to 100 million. And then think about, in your case, the risk. If you had unlimited cash right now, would you have any risk getting to 100 million? On one side, no. On the other side, yeah. There's the unknown risk. Of all the known risks, you could mitigate those probably with money.
Right.
But then there's the unknown risks of, and to be extreme, like COVID and stuff that happened.
Right.
So that's why everyone says, let's take the cash now. It's not because it's like, let's play romper room. It's because the more cash you have, the more of a chest you have to manage the unknown things that come up.
Right.
And some of them are positive unknowns, an acquisition opportunity. Boom, if we get those folks, they're doing a service industry over there, but look at their client base. We can put them on the SaaS and we model and tweak that up and that's going to be excellent, right? You got to be thinking that.
Right.
While you're kind of debating how much of this hard-earned equity do I give away to that private equity person, it's also thinking, okay, like I think you are, how much faster can I go?
Yeah.
So I think that'll be the balance between the bank. The bank will give you less, private equity will give you more, private equity will take more, But having more, does that get you the support from your account management team so that you can stay focused on strategy and really raising the next round? Because once you take it, it's like a drug. You're going to want it. Well, the reason is to get to 8 million run rate so you can get that next round, so that you can get 50 million, so you can get to 100 million, not over five, maybe not over 8 years, if I'm overly generous, but in 4 years, you know, because I've got the backing, I'm hitting those milestones, the next folks are in. Each time I'm giving away a little bit, yes, but my portion is worth a lot more and I get there faster and the cash mitigates a lot of the unknown risk.
So let me ask a question. I mean, I think the secondary piece is something that could wait, right? But my recommendation has been, let's accelerate the growth rate. Let's have the SaaS products become a larger portion of revenue.
Yes.
And then do a raise of any kind, whether it be selling a majority stake or a minority stake, that could come, but let's have a higher trajectory and cliff.
Yeah. That's what I do. Yeah. I was thinking I wouldn't even have those conversations until the end of 2020 when we got, you know, more revenue, SaaS revenue.
Yeah. So Eric, is this a deal that without a VC or PE that Silicon Valley Bank would look at?
Yeah. I'm going to tell you a little bigger to other banks too, what you think again, like a banker. So we talked about the equity side. Now we'll come back over to the banker side. The bankers, what you'll have there is you're going to lose speed and size driven by size of dollars. So like as a bank, I think this is pretty accurate with most banks. The things I'm going to be looking at is, I imagine your clients are paying ahead of time, so I don't have much AR.
So Eric, you're thinking about the SaaS revenue and how fast that's coming in. Is that what you guys were
Absolutely. Talking about? Absolutely. Right. Okay. Cause here's the problem. If I give you, let's say, getting to 5 million on what I got to look at is, yeah, I can look at your recurring revenue, but in driven largely by the services side.
Yeah.
The bank is going to say, I can't, just like we can't control the IP, I can't control that customers might change because that's all project-based work. Right? Yeah. I got no long-term contracts. I got no visibility to 6-8 months out. AR, of course you can finance that, right? You get 80% of your AR. So you already get to about, you know, call it 1.8, maybe up to 2 million on the AR side of things.